Hi friends, you are welcome. Friends, there were two fast friends who talked about English literature, who talked about poetry, who talked about the very concept of literature. Many times they have discussions on various aspects in literature, and these two friends are very famous in English literature, and among them we find there is agreements and disagreements regarding various aspects of literature. For example, they talked about imagination and the role of imagination in composition of poetry. Friends, in this video we are talking about William Wordsworth and S.T. Coleridge. So friends, in this video we are going to discuss about Biographia Literaria by S.T. Coleridge and what were those arguments among his friend or first companion William Wordsworth. Why did he oppose William Wordsworth in certain kind of opinions? And this is his very treatise, Biographia Literaria, in which we find his critical opinion. So friends, this video is the exposure to William Wordsworth's idea of imagination and other different aspects he talked in Biographia Literaria. So friends, let's start Biographia Literaria and S.T. Coleridge's critical opinions. Friends, if you think about S.T. Coleridge, we find that he is famous as a romantic poet, but he is equally held valuable as a critic poet. He is one of the most celebrated critic poets in romantic age, and still we think about his criticism. Yeah. Friends, we find the major critical concepts occurred of S.T. Coleridge in two his seminal works. The very first is Biographia Literaria, which is published in 1817. The second book here we have Lectures on Shakespeare and Other Poets. These lectures are loosely or irregularly delivered between 1808 to 1819 for the students, and all these lectures based on his practical criticism. But here our main concern is Biographia Literaria, and what did he say, or what are the concepts he delineated in this Biographia and Literaria. So friends, let's begin with the very plan of Biographia Literaria. Biographia Literaria is comprised of 23 chapters and it has two volumes. The first volume consists of 1 to 13 chapters and the second volume has 14 to 23 chapters, but later again one chapter is added to the second volume, and now we have 24 chapters in Biographia Literaria. So friends, what are the major concerns of S.T. Coleridge, or what are his criticism of William Wordsworth, as we find it is in the second part of Biographia Literaria, that is from chapter 14 to chapter 23, and the last chapter is in the form of conclusion. So let's start with his most famous concept, that is his concept of imagination or the theory of imagination. What did he say about imagination? So it has given in the fourth chapter of Biographia Literaria. In imagination, he says that, as we find from many centuries, there was a debate about literature or about poetry, that poetry is an imitation or literature is an imitation. But for S.T. Coleridge, it is not only an imitation, it is the product of imagination. For the first time, he has diverted the very criticism of literature from its imitation to the imagination, and he says that it is the manifestation of imagination, or poetry is the sheer product of imagination. So this is his concept of imagination. While talking about the concept of imagination, he also talks about fancy, and he says that there is difference between fancy and imagination, and he has given separate entities as imagination and fancy. So what is the difference between this imagination and fancy? Let's understand this difference with a table. So I have prepared a table in which we find imagination and fancy separately described. So friends, imagination is a creative faculty. Fancy is common to all human beings, which is not creative. It is a dynamic process, creates new images, imagination. Again, fancy is the mechanical in nature and processes already existed images. So this is significant. So imagination is original, as we see, and fancy is the artificial, or it is a mechanical in nature. The next difference here we have, imagination has unifying power, whereas fancy creates shapes and modifies the images, because images are already existed. The next difference here we have, imagination is original faculty of human mind, and you find this faculty in many human minds, and through which we get the great poets. And fancy collects and presupposes imagination. It is completely based on imagination. The next difference, imagination is an original act of creation and fancy systematically synthesizes or combines sensory images. Next difference here we have, it is superior as it has power of creation. Fancy is not superior, it is inferior to imagination as it has power of combining. The very task of fancy is to combine various images or various things in poetry. The next difference we have, imagination has a creative power to transform the existing objects completely into now new. Fancy takes the help of imagination to reshape and reconstruct the already existed objects or already existed images. Coleridge thinks about imagination as a separate entity and fancy as a separate. And here in this fourth chapter of Biographia Literaria, repeated meditations led me first to suspect, and more intimate analysis of the human faculties matured my conjecture into full conviction that fancy and imagination were two distinct and widely different faculties instead of being, according to the general belief, either two names with one meaning or at furthest the lower and higher degree of one and the same power. So friends, he very clearly distinguishes between imagination and fancy, that imagination is creative faculty whereas fancy is not creative. And he has cited the example of Shakespeare, that for him the poetry of Shakespeare and poetry of Milton is completely based on imagination, or it is the imaginative faculty. And the poetry of Cowley or the poetry of other poets, contemporary poets, is the example of fancy, or the poetry of Cowley is fanciful. So these examples he has provided. And again we find further he goes into the explanation of imagination, and he bifurcates or categorizes imagination in two categories, that is primary imagination and secondary imagination. So what is primary imagination and secondary imagination? Let's understand. Because for him, primary imagination is something that which everyone possesses, and secondary imagination is the part of poet, or it is the product of the genius mind of poet. So again, I have a table, and in that table we understand primary and secondary imagination. So primary imagination is the basic faculty to all humans, senses the outer world. Secondary imagination is the poet's faculty, senses the inner world, that is psychology of the poet. Primary imagination is a static faculty and pre-existed. Secondary imagination is a dynamic faculty derived from primary imagination. Primary imagination is in the form of raw material presented to poet. Secondary imagination uses raw material to renew and reshape it to create the fit images. It brings forth the objects to the senses or perception. Secondary imagination dissolves, dissipates, diffuses the objects to recreate them. So friend, this is the difference and semblance between primary and secondary imagination. Or again, he talks about the fancy and imagination. So here are the lines. Full gently now she takes him by the hand, a lily prisoned in a gold of snow, or ivory in an alabaster band, so white a friend, younger, so white a foe. So these lines are taken from the memory, or these lines recites just memory, and hence it serves as the fit example of fancy. And again here we have next lines, that is, look how a bright star shooteth from the sky, so glides he in the night from Venus's eye. Now friends, here we find the secondary imagination, because secondary imagination combines, or secondary imagination is the manifestation of the creative mind of artist, the creative mind of poet. And in this example we find that, or we common people, as we know that we know sky, we know about Venus, we know about star, we know about everything in nature, but we don't know how to combine these into a particular composition to find a great effect or to form a particular effect. So it is the poet who can combine them, who can include his own genius into these objects to form a particular effect. So this is the concept of imagination he talked in chapter 4th of Biographia Literaria. So let's move to the next point. What did he say in the next point, or his concept of art? So what is the concept of art? So friends, in this concept of art, he talks about imitation and imagination. So art is not an imitation only, but a product of imagination. Again, he says that this product of imagination has a power of combining, a power of synthesis. And through this secondary imagination, poet forms a particular effect on the mind of readers or the mind of audience. And here we find that he agrees with his friend or companion Wordsworth in this regard. In other concepts, for example, language or diction, he is not show his agreement with Wordsworth, but here in the view of art or in the view of poetry, he shows his agreement. So here we have his words: "It was the union of deep feeling with profound thought, the fine balance of truth in observing, with the imaginative faculty in modifying the objects observed, and above all, the original gift of spreading the tone, the atmosphere, and with it the depth and height of the ideal world around forms, incidents, and situations of which, for the common view, custom has bedimmed all the luster, had dried up the sparkle and the dew drops." Thus, the imagination plays a very crucial role in the composition of poetry, in the composition of literature. And according to S.T. Coleridge, it is not possible to form a great literature without the imagination, or secondary imagination for that matter, he said. So this is his concept of art, or this is his concept of literature. Now friends, we have his next critical idea, that is, what is poetry, or what is poem, the very third idea. Now friends, he uses poem and poetry as separate words or separate entities, and he has made difference between a poem and poetry. Now what is the difference? Let's see. He says that poetry has a particular truth which is not there in the poem. So poem is the outcome of fancy, and poetry is the outcome of imagination or secondary imagination. Here generally we find that he says that a poem is nothing but best words in their best order. But moreover, poetry, or about a poem, he says, a poem is that species of composition which is opposed to works of science by proposing for its immediate object pleasure, not truth, and from all other species having this object in common with it, it is discriminated by proposing to itself such delight from the whole as it compatible with a strict gratification from each component part. Now friends, we find that a poem does not include truth as it is there in the science, and there is difference between the language of science and the language of poem or the language of poetry. Poetry contains truth. Poetry, though, has its prime object, the pleasure, but again it also has its object as the truth. So again, he has made difference between the works of science or the works of other genres, for example philosophy, theology, or whatever may be there, and the poetry, because poetry has a very particular kind of composition which includes language very carefully, and we find poetry with a great effect which also can include truth as well as pleasure, but we don't have pleasure in science or any other book. So science does not afford pleasure for its readers. So we will not read science for the pleasure. We read poetry for the pleasure. So this is the distinction. Again, he talks about poetry, and he says that poetry is identical with poet, or it is the synonym of the poet. And to explain poetry, he has given the qualities of poet. What are those qualities? Let's see. The poet, describing ideal perfection, brings the whole soul of man into activity with the subordination of its faculties to each other according to their relative worth and dignity. That he diffuses a tone and spirit of unity that blends and, as it were, fuses each into each by that synthetic and magical power to which I would exclusively appropriate the name of imagination. So the task of poet is higher than the task of a scientist or the task of any other person or common man, because a poet has to combine or bring forth the whole activity of the soul into that poetry, and it has to blend the relation with nature, it has to blend the magical power with nature, and come with a very profound truth before the reader. So this is his concept of poetry and poem. So friend, this is all about his concept of art, his concept of poet and poetry, his concept of imagination, and in the next video we'll talk about his remaining concepts. So thank you very much for watching this video, and stay tuned for the next video on Biographia Literaria.